theory, we should be live. Double check progress. All right.
The one person that might be out there, I'll call the August 11th meeting of the Trees and Greenery Committee to order. And we have acceptance of the minutes of the July meeting. Any comments on that?
So moved.
Seconded by Dick. All in favor of accepting the minutes?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
I say that because Dick doesn't believe in that particular step. But,
I second it.
We have no tree removal requests. How about old
Peter,
business?
I'm who's this lady right here?
Oh. I'm pending. So.
Excuse me?
She's pending.
Oh, okay.
I'm purgatory.
Okay, so have you heard anything?
Nothing but good things, but no, nothing official. I know it's a procedural thing.
Okay.
Thanks for all the encouragement and support.
Tentatively welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Old business. Why is that likely?
What's going on with
I'm sorry, Dick, could you pull the mic towards you?
Yep. I asked what's going on with Little Harbor. I mean, any number of people assured me that disaster lies ahead with the wasteland, and clear cutting, and so on and so forth.
Chuck, I got one. No updates from Eversource. I was told that they would let us know well ahead of time before they plan on doing any work there. I can assure you, I don't think there will be any wasteland left over. I think it'll look pretty similar. But I will let everyone know as soon as I know. I was told I will know at least a week ahead of time. So,
just to follow up on that, I'm meeting with Scott and some of his folks at the end of this week to look at the trees on our end. So he's still, working on the scheduling of that. We might be using part of the Coolidge Mansion as a laydown area for their stuff to set up a parking lot. So when we get our, when we figure out our end, that kind of stuff, I'll keep it posted.
Thanks. Thank you. Anything else? Any other old business?
It appears to me that the plantings have taken place at Plaza 800, the trees on Islington Street. Have you looked at those, Dick?
I have not, no.
Looks like four locusts and two darn redwoods.
Well, I have been mentally giving you and Dick credit for seeing that happened.
It's been a long drawn out process. Yeah. The trees are in the ground.
Yeah, they look good.
Who selected the species?
I believe our cousin.
Don Redwood seemed to be singularly inappropriate for that.
Those two, if I identified them correctly, are down closer to the Bank of America building.
No overhead utilities, I think. So I'm pretty open there.
Big planting space. Okay.
Weren't there some large spruce there at one point too? I mean, I seem to recall there was some large.
There's still one.
Yeah.
Kind of on.
Well, anyway, thank you, Dick.
Yes.
Any other old business? Any new business? Well,
we have one, have some new business regarding issue we have with right-of-ways and sidewalks. The current concern is we will get a service request, whether it's by telephone or C-Click fix system. An example would be that a private shrub over the years has completely overtaken a sidewalk. Most recent service request I can think of is that a mother can't push her stroller down the sidewalk on the one-way section of Woodbury where it meets Bartlett. Historically, we've been in touch with legal, and legal will send a letter for the homeowner to have their shrubs pruned. And sometimes that works, and it's just a matter of, you know, reminding them. Sometimes these shrubs have been let go to the point that pruning only gets you so far. And that this is a great example of that. However, we have not been the ones to say after 30 days, we're going to come in and get them off the sidewalk. It will be, you know, very impactful. And I don't think we've always strayed away because of what will be left. You know, the city came and destroyed our shrub, but it's puts us in a weird situation because the right of way is blocked. It's a private shrub. Not saying we have to necessarily always remove the shrub, but a lot of times we have to cut them in half. We're trying to figure out what to do. Do we move forward with after 30 days? Sorry, but we have to open up the right of way, or do we leave it as this kind of gray area currently? I see a liability issue possibly.
Yeah, I think by liability, if we're put on notice of a safety issue, we have a certain amount of time to take action. So if somebody was hurt and we were aware of the safety situation, we'd be held liable and our insurance carrier would not be happy that we knew something needed to be addressed. Obviously, this is something that we're reluctant to do. And bringing it to the committee that we want to just have the opportunity to speak about it publicly so that people understand that this is not something that the department takes lightly. That we evaluate each situation and we can work with the property owner to either maintain the hedge in some reasonable manner or, you know, work with them to come up with an alternative solution. We'll do that. Unfortunately, we're at a point, this particular case, where we're not able to do that. The individual has indicated that they're really not willing to do more than has been done. So bringing it up, we thought that it'd be an opportunity to have just some discussion about it and get the committee's thoughts. But ultimately, at the end of the day, it is an administrative issue from the department standpoint. But we wanted the committee to be aware of it because I know you folks get a lot of feedback from people. And it's likely to stir some controversy if it gets traction with either city council or the newspaper or something like that. So that is why we're bringing it forward.
Chuck, I'm trying to find the insect here on Google, but what's the species? And some hedges.
I want to say it's a yew. I had to, okay. Or privet.
Some species can take to real hard pruning better than others.
It would probably be fine the next year. I don't have a fear of that. It's just, it's going to look
that
scary. For a little bit. And this isn't the only location. There is more locations that haven't been brought to our attention. We're just kind of.
I think that you, we have a beech tree up middle and we took it up, but I think you guys came and took it up even more and you did a great job. It looks wonderful. And then I also have some roses on middle.
Yeah,
not only do I have the beech tree, but we have a rose bush. And there's some gentlemen, some women that are in wheelchairs, and they've come by and just said that my bush is reaching out to them. And so I go out and cut it, but it is a concern, safety concern, but also people that are in wheelchairs that are moving around the town.
So what we're intending to do is start, this particular case is more something that's farther along, but we're planning on doing more of an outreach effort. We'll work with our outreach coordinator, Stephanie Secord, to do a press release and post something on the website, do a tweet, and just start and a memo to city council so they're aware that this is an issue and that we're moving forward to address this concern. So you may hear a little bit of flack or people giving their opinions, as we start with this effort more in earnest. So
I've been by the apple tree in front of Deb's house, and I'm always tempted to
do my part by attempting to prune it apple by apple.
Peter, people do.
But despite the discussions at the end of the last meeting, I think that the city's ability to prune growth over the sidewalk is very clear. And I have spent a lifetime of studying useless and arcane aspects of the law. And that part, I think, is very, very clear that, with the ownership and all that, but it's interfering with the passage. And I noticed it running, and I'm thinking if it was a wheelchair or a baby carriage, it would be very, very
Peter, a number of years ago, we had an issue like this. I think it was on Lybert Street. Somehow the name Roger Clem comes to mind, but I could be wrong. Do you recall that? Anyway, whoever's owned those shrubs allowed them to take over the sidewalk almost completely. And I think we cut them back, but I can't recall for sure.
I recall an intersection of Broad and Lincoln. There was a property there that had aggressive hedges that were getting out into the space. And that we worked with the property owners. They said, yeah, go ahead and do it if you want to, but I'm not going to do it. So we went through and cleaned it out. We appreciate what you're saying, Peter. We do understand that we have the legal right to do it.
It's political rather than legal.
Yeah, it's the challenge is just because we can do it doesn't mean doing it always is helps.
Yeah, I think they'll. Yeah, and to speak to like the Beach Street, it's easy to make it to raise it off the sidewalk and also make it look like they've never been there. Some of these shrubs.
It is a great job.
Thank you. Thank you, Max. But some of these shrubs, I think it's just I think it'll be unavoidable to have a little bit of pushback after the fact. Mm-hmm. It's a safety issue.
I think it's I've noticed in the last week. Some intersection where you have to pretty much get into the travel lane to see from some growth on, I can't remember where it is, someplace that's fairly
past, along Middle Street.
And also I was coming out on my scooter today and I don't really know who, on Cabot we have a lot of bump outs and they've gotten really overgrown and look very untidy. And I'm not sure whose responsibility is it. The one right on Cabot and Middle across from me, it's very high with weeds.
Like the green strip grows into the bump out.
Yeah, the bump out right there in the corner. And they're probably 3 feet high. It's really hard. I haven't had the time to go over and do it myself.
So a couple of things there. There's the green strip, and then there's also, are you also experiencing weeds coming out of the sidewalk, I'm sorry, the curb itself where it meets the road, or is this coming out of the green strip or all of it?
This is all of it.
We aren't doing any weed spraying this year.
I've noticed
which
that.
Is a, mm-hmm. I've definitely noticed.
And why aren't you doing that this year? Curious.
Last year, our budget was cut $150,000.
Okay.
This year, we had to absorb close to $260,000 of additional increases without raising our budget. So we have not had a budget increase in 3 years. So something has to give. And I explained this at a council session that what would slide would be adult deciding mosquitoes. So mm-hmm. if you've noticed, we have not been spraying the streets mm-hmm. at all. And weed control. So weed control has been something that's been dropped off. So we do, we do make an effort to do mechanical weed control with the street sweeper. And when it gets, certain areas like the downtown area, the parking crews do pick weeds. And we're trying not to allow the establishment of woody types of vegetation, small trees or stuff like that getting into the curb lines. But it does lead to a greener street.
And the green strip is the property owner's responsibility.
Yeah, I mean, we depend upon residents to take care of the green strips. And I know along that area of Cabot, there are quite a few absent landlords.
Correct.
So they probably just don't come by periodically. But we do encourage people to take care of their green strips. At the end of the day, we often will go down once a year and knock it back. But it's not something that we currently that's not a service that we currently budget for.
Mm-hmm. So Peter, the sidewalks are city property, correct?
Yes, and Peter Lachman can probably describe it.
Okay, so for maintenance though, say weeds, weed control.
Yep.
Should homeowners, we should just be doing that ourselves if they're growing up through the sidewalk.
What I would encourage people to do, and I know, what I do is I'll go through and hit with vinegar or I'll hand pick it. But I would encourage residents to help out, if they so choose, it's not required. But if they feel that's something that they would like to do, that'd be great.
Okay. That's good to know.
Would that be something that you might want to message?
It's a
website to say, we've been cut, and so maybe you might want to just do a little tidying up yourself.
That's a difficult thing for staff to be saying.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Could we be saying it?
I can. That is an individual resident's choice and committee member's choice. I am not going to say yes or no to something like that.
Any other business, Mike?
Chuck, could you give us an update on your success of the European fruit planting, and have you replaced those that didn't make it?
So, answer your second question. We have not. We won't replace any trees that didn't make it until the following season, just because of our order. We can put together our order trees all at once instead of piecing in trees. And we're incredibly successful, and I think the weather this year has really helped out as well. We have, just for everyone who didn't meet Max, Max is our crew leader in the field doing work every day. He's a certified arborist, and he's watering trees today. We have Max really did an incredible job actually planting all the trees with Steve. And some other folks at Public Works this year. And there's a lot, it was a new, whole new thing for us, the bare root trees. There are a lot of nerves around it. Is this gonna work out? It was a lot to process, but I can say that we've been incredibly successful. We couldn't be happier. And I'd say, as a rough tally, the Zelkovas were the ones that didn't make it. And we had one swamp white oak in front of Dick's house. However, by July 4th, at least half of those Zelkovas decided to leaf out. So we'll see. That might be the final push of their stored energy, and they're not going to do well next year, but I'm hopeful about it. I'd say we planted over 100 trees. We have 8 or so that are struggling. And we're down tens of thousands of dollars from planting 35 trees. We spent around 5,000 ish. Give you the exact. I plan on doing a presentation this fall once we know our exact numbers of what made it. But incredibly successful, and the trees are growing like crazy. We did it all in a couple weeks. So
Chuck, maybe you can give a quick description of what the difference of bare root versus the. The traditional approach that's used.
So there's a few. So there's a lot of difference, but when you buy a bald and burlap tree, there's a couple things to point out. Is oftentimes the nurseries actually buy bare root trees to turn them into bald and burlap stock. So you'll see we wholesaled all our bare root trees from Schichtel's Nursery in New York. If you go to many nurseries in New England and you buy a bald and burlap tree, the Schichtel's tag is still on the tree. So there's kind of a middleman factor there, but there are some benefits to bald and burlap. You can get a bigger tree most times. But the downside is they weigh, a 2-inch bald and burlap weighs 500 pounds. You have cage, you have soil, you need to find the trunk flare, and you're getting rid of all the soil. You need to throw the cage out. You need a piece of equipment all the time to plant the tree, bigger hole, and a tougher establishment because the root system isn't as nice. They're bigger. The bare root is dug from the field with a giant root system. They're a tad smaller, so instead of 2-inch, we really plant a 1 3/4 inch. But we were really impressed. The trees are actually fairly tall, most of these, looking at 8 feet or so. They come from the field, they're immediately dipped in a hydrogel that preserves the root system. They're put in trash bags, shipped to us on a refrigerator truck. And from there, you have about 10 days to plant them, but they weigh, you know, 20 pounds a piece. And Max and Steve and one other guy can plant over 100 in 2 weeks, where it took us probably a month to do four a day with tons of soil and work with Paul and Berla. So anyways, we took the leap, and moving forward, I think we spent, give you the exact figures, but let's say it's $400 a tree, roughly, sometimes more for a 2-inch bald and burlap. We were paying $89 a tree for bare root. So major savings, way less taxing on staff, better root system, way shallower holes, and it's proven to be successful. I mean, even if we had had five times the losses that we currently have, we would still be way above our numbers for bald and burlap. We'd still be way above the money, as well as a bunch of other things. So this year has proven that it's the way to go. We really took the idea. I stole it from a friend who plants the trees in Cambridge, and there's some other towns and some bigger cities. And we actually just got the catalog for next spring. Yeah, we just got that in the mail, so we'll start going through. But yeah, it's been amazing to see. It's I was definitely nervous that, you know, maybe this will be a fail, but you don't know until you try. But it has not been a failure. The Zelkovas, I think, were just a weird thing, but most of them made it. We just have a few that didn't. But Max had pointed out that when they were planting the Zelkovas, you could actually see something was funky about the root system. You know, some of the trees, you get a nice fibrous root system. I think he was saying most of the Zelkovas, it's like, there's not much here. But I don't know if that answers everyone's questions.
Thanks, Chuck. And you know, I know a lot of you already knew a lot about that, but where this is recorded and gets posted, I thought it was appropriate to, one, to highlight the work that the staff does, and the value that the residents get from this investment. I mean, it's, you know, having qualified staff really goes a long way to improve the quality of life and the aesthetics of the city. So it's something that, you know, we as a department are very, very proud of. And Chuck and Max and the crew do a great job. So,
consistent with what Peter just said, this bare root planting and the whole program really only works if you have a very dedicated staff. I mean, anybody can go and stick a tree in the ground, but doing it with care, and I've just, you know, observed the people, and people have mentioned to me that people don't particularly think about trees or care, but say they've noticed the diligence of the crew watering and taking care of the trees. It's, to me, it's evident, and it's wonderful. It's inspiring.
I agree.
And thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other new?
I sent out an email after our last meeting about the database that Eversource was shown us at our last meeting about the time that downtime when service wasn't available to customers, how long it was. It included both private trees that failed as well as our trees that failed. And it seemed to me, especially after that Middle Street tree failed, that really bumped that number up tremendously. And so one of my suggestions was that somehow we'd be able to get a hold of that database and be able to pull out the failures from city trees that caused outages, so that we have a better idea how much outages there were and were they where Eversource had done work previously and how long ago. And that was one item that was in there. And another item that was in there was, and we've been talking about the Little Harbor Road trees quite a bit, and knowing that there was a lot of controversy about
whether trees should go down or not. I asked that we be given, that Chuck be given their schedule of when they're going to be taking trees down, so that if anybody on the committee wanted to see a particular tree, see it before it went down and see it after it went down, it's a great way to sort of sharpen our eyes about what's going on inside of trees. And so I ask that we have that ability as well. Not to say that everybody's going to go look at every tree that Eversource takes down, but the one that Chuck sent us a picture for, the one on Middle and Madison, that red maple that a couple of us hadn't looked at. I think Brad looked at it and Pat looked at it as well. And Scott and I sort of disagreed with how much decay was inside of it. And then afterwards, when Chuck sent the picture, there was a lot more decay than I thought was going to be in there. And that sort of really helps us to focus our eyes. And so for not just the Little Harbor Road trees, but all the trees that Eversource has taken down, I thought it'd be great if they could tell us in advance, you know, maybe 24 hours in advance when those trees are coming down, so that anybody that wanted to see a particular tree, that had questions about a particular tree, could see it and maybe be there when it came down and see what it looked like on the inside.
Makes sense. Mr. Chairman. Dennis, I think these are really interesting ideas. However, as I just explained, our resources are very limited, and for us to take on extra activities is really outside of our ability to do that. It would detract from our ability to do what we do now. I think your second suggestion, maybe something, you know, we typically bring those trees forward that are within the city right away to the committee, so the committee gets to see those in advance, and then, you know, the, you know, being informed of when they're coming down. I think that's probably something that we look to do. But there's a lot of things that we'd love to be able to do if we have resources. The challenges are balancing the needs, given the resources we have. As you've seen, we've taken on additional planting styles. And yes, there's a cost savings to it. There's also a labor aspect to it. The watering is time consuming. I mean, during the drought period,
it's a lot more trees.
And during that time period, we're dedicating a full body to watering.
Two
bodies to watering. These are great thoughts. If the committee members would like to take these activities on as part of their committee duties, that's something, you know, that would be beneficial. But I just would just encourage folks to, when you know, the additional report backs and things like that are all things that, you know, we don't have a lot of support staff. Oftentimes, you know, you'll hear requests and either myself, Chuck, end up having to do that on top of all the other work that we're doing. So, you know, while I truly appreciate what you're asking for, and it would be great in an ideal world for that additional information, we are not at the point where we can do that.
Just to kind of also chime in on that, I think the scheduling wise, like the Little Harbor is a good example. It's a bigger job. We get notified, but I think it's not possible for me, like Peter said, to try and figure out Eversource's schedule, but I think it is possible, like if you were to contact Scott and say, can you let me know? And then put the ball in Eversource's court. Eversource may say, we're not able to give you our day-to-day schedule because they are doing it every day, you know, just because they're not doing a city tree every day, they're doing someone's tree every single day.
Right.
We can look to ask them. I mean, the gas company sends us.
I could tell you that.
I just think it'd be better because then it's not a game of telephone of, hey, Dennis, I think they're going to be on this street
right. Tomorrow.
And then right. It turns out one guy calls in sick. I mean, who knows? And then the other point I wanted to say was the data. Because I think we had briefly mentioned that to Bob Allen, and he said that they did not have that sort of distinction, or maybe it was Scott, between what's city and what's not. I think that, once again, is an Eversource issue. I mean, if the Trees and Greenery Committee goes to Eversource, can you distinguish this data for us? They may be able to, or they might say, no way. I, I think it's doubtful that they, when they go show up on a storm damage, I think they don't have any information on what's in the right of way or not. If it's a major tree, you know, I'll get a call like on Middle Street. Hey,
right.
they pretty much know it's a, I don't think they're writing anything down. It's a private or public tree. I'd be amazed if they were.
And it's almost impossible for them to do that because every town takes it differently of who owns that tree.
Right.
City of Portsmouth has a very different view on, you know, the ownership of trees than just other towns around here.
Right.
You know, Concord, for instance, you know, they don't want to own any tree downtown, whether it's in the sidewalk, in the planting, anything, you know, it's just, they put it back to the homeowner to try to get the homeowner to care for that. It comes back to resources and everything else. So Eversource, and we have the numbers, the initial person going there may have no training in trees whatsoever. They're the closest person with a pickup truck with a light on the truck, and they go there. And they're assessing wires and, you know, they're built stuff, not necessarily what the tree is, but they're calling, you know, they're making those calls initially to where that tree is. Is it in the road? Is it on the wires to take down poles? So they have their training in their industry, but not where that tree came from or whose ownership it is or whatever else. As far as Little Harbor Road goes, I mean, you're looking at a week's worth of work down there with crews, trucks, cranes. I mean, it's not just going to happen Monday and they're going to go away. I mean, they're probably there 4 or 5 days, two or three bucket trucks and a crane. So they won't know what day they're going to get to what tree,
right.
But they'll be able to tell you, hey, this week we're going to, you know, don't drive down Little Harbor Road. That's going to be a little full. You know, it depends how they plan their job, but you know, they're going to have, you know, 100-foot-tall bucket truck and 100-foot-tall crane and, you know, all that kind of stuff. You're going to see it on the street. Do they have to make traffic plans?
They handle all that stuff, yeah.
So they'll make their traffic plans, you know, that kind of stuff. So, I mean, it's out, you know, a few weeks anyways, probably. As far as going on to the job site, that's a really tight area. So they're not going to want folks, you know, hanging out, you know, watching where that tree is coming from. No safety gear, no hard hats, you know, no all that kind of stuff, because I mean, the road's already really narrow. The trees are, you know, adjacent to the roadside. So that tree has to, you know, come down in pieces, lay down the road, get into the chipper, you know, get the log truck in there. So it's going to be a really tight site to show up. I'm working right now with the folks over at the Creek Farm, and we're going to try to put together a program to repurpose some of that wood. So we could cut or mill open one of those really rotted logs. And show people what, you know, the ant damages. We know some of those trees have ant damage inside of them. But we're also going to try to repurpose some of the good wood. But I'm just going to work out the logistics with Scott on that before we, you know, figure out where all that wood is going when it leaves it.
So I wouldn't expect that Eversource would be differentiating between public trees and private trees. But what I was envisioning was if we could get someone, and not necessarily on your staff, but someone maybe from the Forest Service, from their urban forestry program, or from your urban forestry program, to work with a GIS system where they could more easily determine whether a tree is a public tree versus a private tree, not in all the communities in New Hampshire, but in this particular community, then we could separate that data out. And there wouldn't be any more time required of you guys, and it would just be a clearer picture for us of the actual outages that are occurring from our trees.
I think
it might be an interesting project.
We could probably do it,
John Parrish, for example, or somebody on his staff.
We could probably do it going back within a year or so, because we can pull the image of where the tree was, you know, on Google or, you know, wherever else. I don't know.
You'd have to overlap GIS data from one organization to Eversource's GIS data.
So I can't do that, obviously.
No. No.
If somebody's looking for a project on this, John.
Yeah.
John's no longer there, but yes. There will be a new John at some point, just retired. I can ask Bob, you know, how specific that data is to the location. Everything in the Eversource's world is all based on pole numbers. So I don't know if they know where the tree was or just between two poles, because that gets them and their crews to those locations. by the time a tree's down across the road, you can see it from one pole to another. So I'd have to go on some of the memory of you guys in town to know where that tree was. You know, you'd have to know, you know, they're going to have a pole number on Middle Street, tree came down. But you guys would know that that tree, you know, was a private tree.
So
like the next problem.
I just brought that up for discussion purposes, but I'll certainly get in touch with Scott and see if he can feed me timing for when they're going to do trees in Portsmouth.
Yeah. That's gonna
and
be,
I'll send it out to the committee.
And that's on his administration, you know. He might say,
sure,
EverSource. I don't know what's, yeah, exactly. But, and we're not.
Right.
I mean, he has been great about sending us pictures on Madison Street. You know,
yeah.
I actually didn't ask for those. So he forwarded that along. And then with Little Harbor.
Well, he knew I didn't think there was any decay.
That's right. Pretty rough.
Jack, is it our responsibility to stump grind those cuttings? Or does more of them come back and do that?
Unfortunately, they do not do the stump grind.
Is Waka Bungalow Road considered a private road? Because Northern came through there like a tornado. It took down some massive ash and red oak. We had no involvement, so I'm curious as to why that transpired.
Waka Bungalow has been a dispute about ownership of it for forever. City maintains it. I've never thought there was a question about it, but the city has often taken that position.
It's the definition of the right-of-way and how far off the pavement we own or we were responsible for is kind of the dispute, more so than we've been maintaining it. We've got, you know, utilities in it. We plow it. We pick up trash. It's a public road for all intents and purposes. But it's, you know, is it 2 feet off the edge of the pavement? Is it 4 feet off the edge of pavement? You know, what's the...
Our maps show it as coming from trees. We've never done any removals or anything there because our right-of-way on our map system shows it's barely off the road. So folks call about, I have a dead tree. I think it's in the right-of-way. I look at it. No, it's not. It's your tree. That's what's always been done there.
They took full advantage of that. They took down a lot of trees. We had a vote back several meetings ago on the red oak on Boyd Street, Boyd Avenue.
Yes.
Apparently Dave Randall, who expressed his concern, was a friend of mine. When Northern did arrive for that removal, they chose not to take that tree. So it's still there. They did some pruning, but they left the tree.
Stay of execution.
Jay, I think that's a really wonderful idea about taking some cross sections of some of those trees and putting them at a creek farm and inviting people to come and take a look at it. That's a good idea.
They might actually be building, they're redoing the inside, their educational coordinator down there now. She's redoing the inside of the old parish house. So we've already given them some wood chunks and that stuff for the walls, but they're actually looking at doing a few programs down there, milling the lumber and turning it into bat houses, or we don't know what yet. Because there is some good wood in those trees. We know they're gonna have some metal in them. If we can take some of the upper wood and that kind of stuff, where it's less like they have signs and all that kind of stuff.
That's very encouraging.
We have a new business.
Just a thought to share. Personally, we have woolly adelgid on the only hemlock we have on our property. So it will be treated. Chuck, thank you. I reached out to Scatagua and Chris Kemp came out this week and he's going to treat it and feed it. But it's just a small cultivar called Moonfrost, and Dave Stedman's guys noticed that it had adelgid. So I just thought I'd share that with those of you who have many more trees on your property that you just might want to take a look at.
Okay.
One quick, the red pine stand out at Pierce Island. I don't know if you're familiar with that. Right across from the shipyard on the point there. All the trees started dying back last year, and we assumed red pine scale. The Forest Service came, and Dennis joined his former colleagues, and we took some samples. And sure enough, it's confirmed on all the samples. So those will all be going away, unfortunately, but leaves a blank canvas to get creative with.
So we wait till they die before you take them down? Or?
We're ready to go. It's a matter of just scheduling it at this point.
So how many trees are we talking about? About
30.
Yeah.
And so would that be a good opportunity? Is it a place where we could put some big trees in?
Absolutely.
I've already been
absolutely
asked
tough environment. Very tough.
Big trees.
Yeah.
And where are those? For our
we can definitely plant big trees there. Yeah. It calls for at least a couple shade trees to get huge. Only problem is it is a rough winter right there for any tree. I think that those first 10 years will be tough, but we've grown some great trees just beyond that, headed to the wastewater plant on the left. We haven't had a problem. So I think absolutely.
I think if some of our big trees are coming down and the trees that are being replaced, are the, you know, what those, what are they, the under 10 feet trees for the power lines?
If they're under the power lines, yes. But
anytime we can find a space and put a big tree back in there, I think that's just the way to go. I love
absolutely
that idea.
Yeah, we'll have that on the, hopefully this spring on the planting list, we can do that.
Great.
So, any other new or old business? Thank you all very much, and we'll see you next month.
Let's just shut the door.